so excited about today. It'll be so fun. Thinking about reality as beta real allows you to do is it allows you to realize that history and memory are also the same. Like, not that they're the same as each other, but that they're the same in the sense of they're not stable and they're not fixed, and they are constructions, and they're necessary constructions for us to productively think about being in the world. But we also need to sometimes move into the space of quicksand, because if we take them as absolute truths, absolute reality, we arrive at a dangerous place where they leave out certain other things. So what the beta real offers to memory and history is a kind of more open interpretation, and it allows memory and history to grapple with contradictions, to allow multiple narratives to be in dialogue with each other, and to not to see them as opposing each other, but rather to see the opposition as a really productive space. And that meaning emerges out of that tension. So a good example is what's happening now in Berlin. So they're reconstructing a old historic city palace, and it's in the center of Museum Islands. It's in the center of the city, and that was a historic structure in there since the 14th century, and then it was demolished after the Second World War for various political reasons. And then on the same site, they built the Palace of the Republic for the Eastern government. And then that was demolished when the city was reunified. And so now they're reconstructing this palace. So what does that mean? If we think that as absolute, then constructing that is saying, This is our one idea of what our heritage is and what our history is, and it's just this. But if we just construct that absolutely, then it erases all of the things that happened between when it was demolished and when it's being reconstructed, which is all of the history of the Second World War, of the divided country, and of reunification. And so moving towards something that's more ambivalent is looking for a way that how can we make architectures that can allow for these two buildings, which contradict each other, sit on the same site, can obviously not coexist together, but is there a way in thinking about memory and history, and therefore thinking about architecture and space and tectonics, where we can allow that ambivalence to be part of an understanding or a new understanding of what unity might mean in architecture? So it kind of goes hand in hand with trying to think through intuition or dealing with emotions, dealing with kind of intangible things. So working through a material, it frees you up in a certain way, where you don't have to like previously already construct the end result of where you're going through a diagram or whatever sort of philosophical concept. The material has inherent behaviors in it that will just not let you do what you want. It's just relentless. It just doesn't want to behave the way you want it, and it has its own kind of character. And then I look for materials that have characters that relate to certain ideas I might be thinking about in terms of memory. So for instance, like the mold and the slip casting process is super interesting to me, because no matter what you try to do, every time you cast it, it decays a little bit. Like, there's just nothing you can do about that, no matter how technically advanced we get. And so what if we think with that decay? Because that decay automatically deals with the idea of loss over time. And so then if we just kind of, you know, allow the material to speak to us and we think with it, we're able to sort of work more intuitively and learn from it instead of trying to, with our own constructs, dictate what the reality should be. Yeah, so I think it relates maybe firstly to memory, which then ties to culture and identity, in the sense of, well, one, clay in general always has a memory. If you had kind of like folded it and then like put it back, it'll like, when it shrinks, it'll like remember that fold. So it has a kind of like material memory in its own. But the slip casting process is really interesting, I think also in terms of a group conversation we just had about presence and absence, because there's so many molds that happen in terms of casting one thing. So you have, to cast the thing, you need a plaster mold. To cast a plaster mold, you need another mold. And then that other mold is sort of the original, actually, but it's not quite because it's still altered. And so there's this kind of play between absence and presence, and a sort of double negation that's almost positive again, but also not quite. So there's these kinds of ambiguities in it that really relate to the way like identity politics work and the way that memory works, where it's often things that are not present that are really important, but also often that things are always kind of tied to their opposites. And so when we speak about identity politics, that, you know, the Blue Lives Matter movement moves out, it comes into being as a result of the Black Lives Matter movement, that when we remember something, it is focusing on a specific point, and by focusing on that specific point, we have to put other things out of focus, which is to say we have to forget them. And so this kind of like movement back and forth between presence and absence, like two sides of the same coin, that is inherent to memory and identity, is just part of the slip casting process. And so I think that's kind of amazing about the material, and so you can just think through it because it already behaves in the way that memory and identity.